Over the last couple of years, and it's always a pleasure say a little bit about the Presbytery and bring their greeting and appreciation for all that you do in your community and throughout the wider church. What is the Presbytery? Ted Land, your pastor, knows what Presbytery is because he is a member of Presbytery and not of the local church. Peace River Presbytery consists of 137 ministers, sometimes called teaching elders, 37 congregations, around 15,000 members, and many more affiliate and seasonal members down here in Southwest Florida. We run from Bradenton to Lely. Lely is our South Coast church. In Peace River, we have a mission and vision statement to affirm our congregations, to connect disciples in Christ, and to be the body of Christ together. So, how do we do that? In addition to our stated presbytery meetings, and we just had one in Bradenton, and I know there were several commissioners from Lely. I had an opportunity to speak with you there. We also have volunteers, about 100 volunteers, who work on different committees. The Presbytery's work is also conducted by very, very few staff. We have one general presbyter, who many of you have met, Graham Hart. We have two office assistants, one mission pastor, Miguel, who is down in Immokalee, and a part-time stated clerk. Each committee and team is made up of equal members of pastors and lay people. The nominating committee tries very, very hard to get representation from all of the churches, from all of the areas of Peace River Presbytery. So if anyone here has any interest in the work of the Presbytery, come talk to me after church is over. Your support of the Presbytery is essential. Without you, Mission Peniel and Immokalee would not exist, nor would Bethel Farm Worker Ministry or the Cedar Kirk Camp. So this morning, it's my pleasure to be here and express the Presbytery's gratitude for all that you do in your local community, through the Presbytery, and the church in general. You are a blessing to this community and a blessing to Peace River Presbytery. Thank you.
Thank you, Lil. I'm pleased to see, Lil, we do something silly, crazy, fun here at Lely Church. It started in October when we were wearing pink as Cancer Awareness Month. And then in November, we wore orange because that's the color for Protestants, and we were celebrating the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. In December, we're wearing red and green. And I want to give a special recognition to Reno Frightens, who's got on his green shirt with his red tie. Yes, I've got on a red tie, and Lil's right in there with the rest of us this morning. She's wearing her Christmas angel around her neck, and Lil really is one of the angels, because an angel is one of God's messengers to us, and that's what Lil is. Thank you, Lil, for being with us. Do we have any more announcements this morning? It's time to prepare to worship God.
Thank you.
Apostle Paul charged us to greet one another with a holy kiss. Let us greet one another with a hug, a handshake, and pass Christ's peace one to another. Now let all God's children say,
Amen.
As we join together in our call. During Advent, we wait for the one promised in Scripture.
And then he will be called mighty God.
We wait for the one whose power has no limits and whose strength knows no end.
And then he will be called mighty God.
We wait for the one whose everlasting light can illuminate the darkest night.
And he will be called mighty God.
We wait for one whose mercy never ends and whose faithfulness endures forever.
And he will be called mighty God.
Please be seated.
Today we light two candles. The first candle reminds us of the hope we found in knowing Jesus as our wonderful counselor. As we light the second candle, we reflect on the joy found in serving a God who is almighty, all-knowing, and always present. Continuing our Advent journey, we joyfully celebrate a Savior who brings hope and a God whose power and strength have no limits. Gracious Lord, we thank you for your promises and for coming to earth to be our Prince of Peace. As we continue our Advent journey, help us to know the joy that comes from resting in your power, and help us spread this joy everywhere we go, today and every day. We pray this in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Of the things that are done.
us is clean. But there is mercy for those who call on the name of the Lord, trusting in God's grace. Let us confess our sin. God, our Maker,
we confess that we are not ready to meet you. You call us to repent, but we turn away from you. You wait patiently for us, but we fail to watch and wait for you. Forgive us, God of grace, and embrace us with tender mercy, so that we may be at one with you when all your glory is revealed, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Every valley is lifted up, every mountain is made low. Now the glory of the Lord is revealed, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Hallelujah. Amen.
Thy will be done on earth as it
therefore offer our lives to the Lord.
Shame and fire.
Lord God.
Anja Lee, the mother sheep. Our New Testament reading today is 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 to 15a. Please take your pew Bible and turn with me to page 238. But do not ignore this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like one day. The Lord is not slow about his promise, as some think of slowness, but is patient with you, not wanting any to perish, but all to come to repentance. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief, and then the heavens will pass away with a loud noise, and the elements will be dissolved with fire, and the earth and everything that is done on it will be disclosed. Since all these things are to be dissolved in this way, what sort of persons ought you to be in leading lives of holiness and godliness, waiting for and hastening the coming of the day of God, because of which the heavens will be set ablaze and dissolved, and the elements will melt with fire? But in accordance with his promise, we wait for new heavens and a new earth where righteousness is at home. Therefore, beloved, while you are waiting for these things, strive to be found by him at peace, without spot or blemish, and regard the patience of our Lord as salvation. So also our beloved brother Paul wrote to you, according to the wisdom given to him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Took Isaiah's role as a prophet to the people of God and took Isaiah. Isaiah as a pseudonym, as a nom de plume. Prophets don't always stand alone. Indeed, in the days of the first Isaiah, Isaiah the son of Amoz, between 742 and 687 B.C., and there'll be a quiz on those numbers later, Amos, Hosea, and Micah were also prophesying. God was speaking the same message with different voices in different places at the same time. When Isaiah, the son of Amoz, Amos, Hosea, and Micah were speaking for God, the Assyrian Empire was the enemy, the oppressor. 200 years later, the children of Israel were in bondage, in slavery, in Babylon. The armies of Cyrus, the king of Persia, would conquer Babylon at the end of October in the year 539 B.C. And so to that generation, God spoke through another prophet named Isaiah. Our text this morning is the introduction to this second Isaiah. Now, we tend to think of prophets as proclaiming gloom and doom. If I asked you to draw a picture of a prophet, you'd have a guy with a beard going around with a sign saying, "Repent, the end is at hand." But the second Isaiah is called by God with a specific task. He is to comfort the people. "Comfort, comfort my people, saith the Lord of hosts." Now remember, the Babylonians had destroyed the city of Jerusalem. How timely that we're talking about Jerusalem this week. Solomon's temple was torn down. Not a stone was left upon a stone. The people were transported to Babylon, to the city that was symbolic of all the sin in the world to the Hebrews. And there they were made to work as slaves. Two of the great wonders of the ancient world were the pyramids in Egypt and the hanging gardens of Babylon. I don't think it's an accident that at the time those two great wonders were built, the children of Israel were slaves in captivity in Egypt and in Babylon. Everything that they had gained since their captivity in Egypt was taken away. And what was once a rich and powerful nation, maybe the wealthiest nation on earth during the wise King Solomon's reign, everything was taken away. They had vanished as a nation and become a slave state. Oh, there were a few left behind by the deportation. Sort of like the eastern band of the Cherokee Indians who hid out in the mountains of North Carolina and Georgia when most of their tribe was marched to Oklahoma on the Trail of Tears. There had been a Trail of Tears when the Hebrews were transported to Babylon. And the tears had continued to flow. Even when the captors made them sing their psalms, the songs of the temple, to entertain them. But as the armies of Persia were being assembled against the Babylonian Empire, God calls a prophet from the captive people and tells Isaiah to tell them that it is over, that their sins have been forgiven, and that they are about to go home. The way of the Lord foretold is the royal highway that will lead the chosen people home from Babylon to the promised land. The words of Isaiah introduce John the Baptist in Mark's gospel. And John the Baptist sees himself as preparing the way of the Lord, preparing for the coming of the Messiah. At this time of the year, we prepare once more to celebrate the birth of that Messiah. And it is fitting that we read the words of Isaiah. We yearn for the day when the Christ will come again, when the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. And the herald voice reminds us that time passes, that the grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of God endures forever. God's promise that the Messiah will come was fulfilled in God's own time. And the promise of his coming again will also be in God's own time. Isaiah leaves us with a powerful image, the image of the shepherd. That is the image that Isaiah raises up for us to think about when we think about the coming of Christ. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms. It's the way our text from Isaiah this morning ends. Throughout the Old Testament, the image of God, of the Messiah as shepherd, is the one that gives the nation its greatest comfort. A shepherd loves his sheep. A shepherd will give his life for his sheep. A shepherd puts up with the stupid behavior, the mindless panic, the willful disobedience of the sheep. He never uses his rod or his staff to beat the sheep, but to direct, to guide, to steer, to stop them. Is there anything more peaceful than the vision of a flock of sheep grazing in the green pastures beside the still waters? At almost every funeral or memorial service that I conduct, we recite the words of the 23rd Psalm. I guarantee you, if I started it right now, you could finish it. The Lord is our shepherd. I have often said that the 23rd Psalm is the most comforting text in all of Scripture. There is a great comfort in knowing that the one who is our loving shepherd will also be our judge when we face the final judgment. There is a great comfort in knowing that our loving shepherd is waiting for us at the end of our life's journey. There is a great comfort in knowing that the one who came as a baby born in a stable in Bethlehem of Judea is coming again in glory and might and power. That is the comfort of Advent, and it is the fulfillment of our hope and promises. And it promises the peace for which we so earnestly yearn. I can't help but notice that 25 and a half centuries later, the lambs that were Assyria, Babylon, and Persia, the lambs from whence the armies that devastated the Middle East came, are still the lambs where wars are raging. We pray for peace in our hearts and peace in our world. May the end of warfare and the peace that Isaiah foretold so long ago come to pass. And may the peace that passes understanding rule in our hearts and minds, now and forevermore. Amen. Let us affirm our faith. 11 in your bulletin is common dialogue. Grace.